Outside of what you've heard in that bio, I mean, Buncrana is my hometown. And what I'd like to do is just take you through an interesting journey that I've had over the last few years, trying to answer a few questions about the town. And as in all these situations, there was an original motivation. Why would you do that? And what I've discovered in my life is a lot of times that I engender to do something, there's usually a woman behind it. In this instance, I want to take you to Boston. In 1978, that my home place there, McNutt's boot and shoes store, I was working in the shop, and four American ladies came in. There was Nora, Phoebe, and Marie, and there was Marie's daughter, Anne Marie. And Phoebe asked me, as only Americans can, are you McNutt? And for one brief second, I had never considered that question ever up to that 17 or 18 years old. And I didn't know what to say, so the usual thing is about getting my father. So I brought my father out, Bill McNutt, and I said, there's four ladies from America here who want to talk to you. Phoebe was there with her mother, Nora. Nora McNutt's father was born in Buncrana. And Nora McNutt and my father were cousins. Now, that happened in 1978. I had never considered that or that story until 4 years ago when Baby wrote to me. And Baby said, Larry, I wonder if you could do me a favour. And I said, certainly, Baby. Now, the assumption was all the McNutts in America were born in America. She said, I want you to find out about my grandfather. And Baby's grandfather was a man called John McNutt. John McNutt was born in Buncrana and joined the police constabulary in 1855. I had never heard of John. John's brother was William, and William was a shoemaker in Buncrana. And William's brother, Thomas, was a sailor. There were three McNutts, as they were called then, living in Buncrana at the period of the famine. And Baby asked me a simple question. She said, Larry, I'd love to know what was life like for my grandfather in Buncrana in the 1830s and 1840s and 1850s before he left. And I said, Baby, I don't know. I can describe what Buncrana was like for me. I could even have some sense of what Buncrana was like from in my father's time, and I heard a few stories in my grandfather's time. But I could not, with any sense of knowledge at all, describe the town of Buncrana, what it was like in those 1800s. Now the irony for me is, this was an American connection asking me the questions, and I said to myself, why wasn't I prompted to make these inquiries? So I did. I set out, and the first thing I'll say is this, if you intend to do it, is a very frustrating exercise, because it's a mixture of a lot of things. And what I'm going to do this evening, with your permission, a lot of people around here know that I've asked permission not to open you, so with your permission, a little bit of genealogy, so a little bit of the family history. And you've already seen the first conundrum, and Johnny, the spelling of the surname, the pronunciation of the surname. And recently I went to a talk by a genealogist called John Brennan, and he's written probably one of the definitive books, if you are, in tracing your Irish ancestors. The title of his talk was Never Trust an Irish Surname. And I said, John, you're spot on. And only I heard that, I said, of course I can't trust it. Why can't I trust it? Because in those years, a lot of people weren't educated. A lot of people spoke Irish. A lot of people taking the records didn't understand the accent. So what was common knowledge didn't get translated into the formal records. So a little bit of what I'm going to do tonight will be genealogy Everything that I'm going to mention, you can find online, and it's mentioned in this little booklet. So you can take all of this and apply it to your own family. That's the beauty of genealogy, because everybody here has a story. And when you combine all the stories, you suddenly start describing a community. And when you start describing a community, then you're into local history. And local history is now so important in the fabric of Irish society that it's one of their biggest tourist attractions right across the whole country. We have nearly given ourselves permission to investigate our own family history and subsequently chart a community's history. So this was my motivation to start looking at how this conundrum happened. But Patrick McNutt's father, William, my grandfather, Patrick's brother, so my great-grandfather, William, had a brother, John, that I never knew of until 1978. And I'm going to come back to that to explain how that plays a role. So for Vivi, who is 98, lives in Lynn, outside Boston. Vivi's mother, Nora, left Waterford with her 10 siblings, all children of John, and moved to Boston. And that's where they lived their lives. So the first thing I said is, look, let's see what maps existed. So the first port of call is, where are the early maps of Buncrana, where we can say Buncrana existed? So the first port of call, of course, is all of the resources we have about the O'Doherty. We know about the O'Doherty castles, and there are some wonderful resources there that describe Inishowen and its hinterland. But you have to struggle a little bit to see where is the actual town of Buncrana. So the town of Buncrana, as we know it today, didn't actually exist. Urban settlements in Ireland were relatively new. Ireland was predominantly a rural community. Urban centres outside of Belfast and Dublin didn't exist. The small Buncrana community would have been gathered around the castle. That's where they would have lived, in small communities, primarily farming the land. And you can see reference to it in some very old documents. And this is a brilliant one. If anybody is interested, it's the Annals of the Four Masters. You can see references there to how people lived back in the 1500s and 1600s. But that still didn't give me an answer to my question. G.B. Buncrana was established as a town in. So the next series of maps that you'll encounter is the Down Survey and the Civil Survey. So again, plantation, wars, a lot of the soldiers had to be paid. They weren't really sure of what lands were there or who owned them. So they carried out two surveys. Now they carried out a civil survey and a down survey. And again, all of these maps are available online. So you can go in there, plug in your townland, and it will pull up for you all the details of the lands that were there and who owned them. Now, the reason I'm interested in the Down Survey is because it actually mentions Buncrana Castle. So we know the castle of Buncrana was there, the town was mentioned, and we also get a list of who was living in the areas, and for the first time we start to see where they've recorded the names of families that were living in the area. But the town, as we know it, still didn't exist. So that map doesn't give you a huge amount of information. Now you may ask, why was there a civil survey and a down survey? The civil survey that they did was really, they sent around observers who met local people and asked them, who owns that piece of land? But the down survey, they actually wrote down and did it in a much more organised method. They actually went about it as you would expect any ordnance survey team to do. So the early maps don't give us an awful lot of information other than establishing that it was a rural community with farming practices but no sense of an urban settlement. So what I wanted to do then was establish who was living in the area and how the town established. And what I've got around the room here are various documents that track how the town developed and the various surveys that were carried out, and you can trace from the 1700s how various families moved from the rural hinterland into the town. The tithe allotments tell us some indication of who was paying tithes. After that, we've Griffith's survey, and they're all there. And then the other document we have is the council books, which after Griffith's, every time a tenement, as they called it, changed hands, they would have written in who the new owner was. So you've been able to track all of that. So from my perspective, the early maps, the one thing they gave me was the names of the town lands. And I realised that all my life I spelled our gravel wrong. Has anybody else got that affliction? It's pronounced our gravel. And all the early maps clearly show that spelling that I've been using all my life was incorrect. Now, what we also get here are the early spellings of all the other town lands, plus we get some indication of what families were living in the various town lands. Now, some of these you have to work a little bit to. The spelling may not be the modern spelling. But again, you're starting to see some record collections happening, you're starting to see it being documented, and this was the hearth money loaf. So if you had a hearth, you paid a tax. Now, we think water charges are bad, but you paid a tax if you had a hearth. And obviously, the bigger the house you had, the more hearths you had, and the more hearths you had, the more tax you paid. So that list is incomplete, because the vast majority of the population of Buncrana and its hinterland didn't live in houses with hearths. So what we're seeing here is an advantaged part of society. But what we're also seeing is the concept of paying taxes, paying charges. And we live under that today. Now, we also know we're right in the middle of the penal times. And there's a wonderful poem about Friar Hegarty. But the other interesting thing about the penal times that I discovered recently was this concern by the established church that a lot of the new families arriving into Inishowen spoke Irish. So what would have been called planter families were Irish-speaking families. And the big concern the established church had was they had very few ministers who could speak Irish. So what was happening in Inishowen and its hinterlands, they actually went to a service which was delivered in a language they understood. And the only services that were delivered in a language they understood were often the Roman Catholic services. So a little observation on the population of Inishowen that I certainly didn't fully appreciate. I would always have assumed that the only Irish speakers were those, the indigenous Irish. But here you have new population coming in also speaking Irish. The interesting thing about that book, it's actually available. Google for all our criticisms on it. I've done a wonderful job of preserving some very old and ancient texts. And buried in the middle of that, you find a whole description of Inishowen in the 1600s. So suddenly, for me, Buncrana was starting to emerge out of the mist. A large indigenous population, a new population of English and Scottish settlers, all weaving together a new community with new practices and a new language, a new culture. The interesting thing about that, in the current modern world, if you think about what's the biggest challenge we face today, is the displacement of millions of people from their homelands right across the world. So in other words, there are communities in Ireland, we've already been through that. We know what those challenges are. And when the call goes out to stand up and help displaced people, you only have to look at our own experience. This brings us now into who owned the land and the establishment of the town as we know the town. And the person that we give that credit to are the Bonds. And the Bonds inherited the land after the plantation. Lord Chichester was given it. He leased it out to the Bond family. And like many families at that time, he built himself a castle, built himself a lovely tree-lined avenue, and then built the town to serve the needs of the land and estate. So they're the first, and you can see the maps up here. Some of the earlier maps show great detail the actual landed estate house, the avenue, and the gardens that were around it. Now, in order to achieve that, they had to displace the community that was already there and build a town that was out of sight. So the town was built where the main street is today. And you'll see on the old maps, you have William Street and Townsend Street, the two main streets, Upper Main Street and Lower Main Street. But the purpose was, I want the town not visible from my estate. I just want my lovely tree-lined avenue. So now we have the town up and running. And a lot of urban towns in Ireland at that stage depended on the rural economy. That's where you went to sell your goods at a market. That's where you went to access tradesmen. So all of those services had to start developing in the town. And there's an interesting poster over here. If you want to find out how much you have to pay to sell a pig or a cow, or do any transaction at the Buncrana market, the price is up there. And that went to another gentleman we want to encounter, who was Isaac Todd. And Isaac Todd inherited the land after the Bond. So we have the Bond dynasty. And the interesting thing about the Bond dynasty, the map's out here, so what I'm going to do at the break is invite you just to look at the maps. And also there's the Griffith valuation, which tells you who owned the different plots, to see if you can figure out which families that you may be interested in. Second question, Townsend Street. Who was Townsend? Anybody know who Townsend? Somebody at Townsend was the Lord Lieutenant of Ireland at the time. And I presume William was king. So obviously, George Vaughan was very keen to keep in with the political rulers at the time, and what better way than to name your new town's main streets after the most powerful man in the country at the time. Now, what industries were there? Now, the interesting thing is we know the linen was a big industry, and Wilson's linen mill out in the Swan Park was there. We also had a corn mill. But the sad thing is, there were a number of visitors sent around Ireland at the time, sort of like tour guides, to write up what they thought of the areas. And all they say about Buncrana is it was a village of one street on a little highway over the sea, two little rivers, which give the place its name, and Mr. Vaughan has a fine house and a linen factory that he tried to get going. So that's as you come to the end of the 1700s, what Buncrana was like. It wasn't a significant presence. Now, the Vaughan family also had estates in Fermanagh. And just last year, this is a grandnephew, he left a lot of his wealth to a charter school in Fermanagh. And that school is still actually going today. So, an interesting possibility there, because obviously that family had a big impact, not just in Buncrana, but also in Fermanagh. He died in 1763. Now, the other question Beattie asked me is, what's the proper way to spell the name? And another list available at the time in the 1700s was what was called the Protestant Householder Returns. Again, another census in 1740. It didn't help me very much, because there's no shortage of McNutts and McNaughts and McNaughts, but every one of them spelt it differently. Every combination of McNutt, McNaught, McNaught, McNitt, and then that evolved into McKnight that you could imagine was included on that. So it didn't give me any sense of purpose at all. Now, the freeholder's census was also, if you owned your freehold, you could vote. So freeholder censuses are also interesting, but they only give you a snapshot of who's living in the town. They're only those that were wealthy enough to vote. Now, one individual that I thought was quite interesting, because down at the pier, the salt pans. And one of the big industries at the time in Ulster was salt. It was cheaper to import rock salt, process it by boiling it up in salt water, and then selling it as processed salt. And that was a significant investment by a gentleman called John Bateman, who built the salt pans in Buncrana in 1773. To such an extent that when they did a study of who were the big salt producers, John Bateman was one of them. So there's no doubt Buncrana had its linen, had its corn, had its salt, and of course at that time that was the only way you brought your fish in and you salted them, and that's the way people preserved. He appears on the freeholders list, so obviously he was making money out of salt. He also was what was called a £10 holder as well. So again, so this is the list of anybody they brought in, that if you had £10 you could vote. But again, what we're seeing is there's commerce happening, there's business happening. The town as an urban centre is starting to develop. But the really interesting thing is all of these lists just give you a little snippet of the bigger story. In fact, the frustrating thing is, and they estimate now that if you're looking at records from landed estates, like the Vaughans, or subsequently the Todds, there's a 3% chance that that information actually exists, because a lot of those houses were burnt, a lot of the records were destroyed over the course of the last 100, 200 years. If you're investigating your own family records, census data, Griffith's valuation, there's a 25% chance that you'll find something that's relevant to you. So my advice is, if this is something that you're interested in, be prepared to be frustrated. Because just when you think you've found that little nugget, that little key that's going to explain everything to you, it won't happen. But again, all of these resources are available for you to explore yourself. In relation to Vivi's query about the name, again, I didn't get... Because again, right across Donegal, there was McNutts, McNaughts, and McKnights all over the place. And I really couldn't come back with any definitive account at this point on who it was. Of course, the other big thing in Buncrana was the capture of Wolf Tone. That went into the local paper. He went to college to do law, and unfortunately for him, a few of the army personnel on duty in Buncrana at the time recognized it. So he was unlucky. There's a recent book out on the history of Letterkenny. There was an interesting chapter where for quite some time Letterkenny argued that Wolf Tone was actually captured in Letterkenny. I think they've given up that argument. And you can lay claim to the fact that that is where he was captured, that is where he was recognized, and this is where he was imprisoned out. The significance of that may not appear huge, but 1798 was a big, important rising. And from not just a history point of view, but a local history point of view, it's quite significant. Because that brought in the Act of Union in 1800. They decided we can't let these areas off governing themselves anymore. Let's bring in the Act of Union and take tighter control. Now, at this time in the founder, we know there was a large yeomanry force. We know there was a large constabulary force. And we also know there was significant traffic in and out of the city. This is a poem from 1808, and I just have a bigger copy of it there. But it's just the sentiment of a sailor going out of the city and his last sights of Buncrana as he goes round Donegal here. And the words in it are absolutely beautiful. Now, I don't know how I've counted it, but it's the most beautiful poem as he talks about the tears coming down his cheeks as he heads around Donegal head, never to see fair Buncrana again. So, what that was saying is, those that were living on Buncrana, whether they were working, whether they obviously were leaving with very significant attachments to the area. Now, I presume, as it's there here, it was during the Napoleonic Wars, he may never be able to come back. But it's an absolutely beautiful poem that captures what we still have today. The beauty of Buncrana is that view is still with us today. So we get a little sense that those living in the town, there was industry, there was markets and interactions with the rural community. Those that were leaving with heavy hands. But at that time as well, after the Napoleonic Wars, economic depression hit them. A lot of factories started to close. And this one fascinated me. This was Wilson's. And it sold in 1810. A lot of property changed hands very quickly. And the more you read about this, you actually see Nama in full force in Buncrana in 1810. Properties were being bought up. Properties were changing hand. Landlords were going bankrupt. But this one, what struck me about it was just the sheer investment that Cruikshank, as it was called then, the Cruikshank and Kennedy Mill in 1810 was huge. It was a big operation. But it wasn't just a mill. There was also 100 male and female apprentices whose indentures would be assigned with the concern. So out of the mill, the workers in the mill came from the foundling schools and the charter schools, young girls and boys, and they lived and worked their apprenticeship out at the mill. When they sold it, they were sold with it. Now, and I said, geez, I walked out so hard for years, and I never, ever got it. It has changed my whole perspective on that corner, thinking of hundreds of young children in Morgan there. All ours. Now, I couldn't capture that, but when they did it, the government came in, the British government decided to do, as well as, again, let's put back to what's happening today with the various commissions that are going on. They wanted to do a study of poverty in Ireland. And one of the gears they interviewed worked at Wilson's factory. And I have a poster up there of her testimony of how she worked during the summer from 4 o'clock in the morning right through the day to 10 o'clock at night. And during the winter, it was so cold, they just stayed up all night. It describes what they were fed. And they got gruel, and they got potatoes, and they got more gruel. And if you read that, you just see a life that was cruel and hard, but off its time. So when you put a modern lens on it, you just say this should never happen again. But it's a wonderful account of the life of Buncrana boys and girls in the early 1800s. And for me, it just brought up so many things, because At the moment, we have concerns about child labour in India. We have concerns about child labour in many of the developing economies. And here we see, in 1810, the same scenario in Buncrana. And that is why local history and groups like this are so important. Because if we lose these experiences, if we don't document these experiences, inevitably we allow circumstances to happen where we just were eaten. So just have a read of that. Mary McCarthy, I think was the girl's name. The interesting thing is, after she finished her apprenticeship at Wilson's Mill, she was free to go. And he paid her 20 shillings. She went to Ballycastle and then found her way to Dublin. And then in Dublin, found she had no money left. And the reason she was interviewed by this inquiry into the poor in Ireland is she was in an asylum for the poor in Dublin. Now, the other interesting thing is, she in no way criticises the owners of the linen factory. In any way, she just said, look, in fairness, I had a job, it was very hard, I got paid, but I was allowed to go afterwards. That's one voice of hundreds. And I often think of the children in Buncrana now, who, you know, probably at school are asked to study history, and they're saying, what has this to do with me? This is so boring. And here they have living history on their doorsteps. Real life boys and girls like them that have a very different job. And the beauty of technology now is it's all available for them. It is accessible and it is available. So if we were living there, what else might we be doing in the town? Well, another interesting account that is a sea fence line. So during the Napoleonic War, when Ness was built, the big concern was we need to watch out for Napoleon's armies coming in. So fishermen were recruited as sea fencers, sort of like a volunteer guards, volunteer service. And in Buncrana, there was 859 of them. So they were, if someone was bloody worried about Napoleon coming down this way. But you can also see fishing obviously was a big industry, but here you had an opportunity to earn something extra as a sea fencer. And you can also see they're all around the coast. Killy Beggs, Ken Mayer, Harry Fergus. What a huge number of men enrolled as sea fencers in Buncrana. Simply to keep watch for the threat of Napoleon. The other interesting is yeomanry. 150 yeomen stationed in Buncrana. Now, I'll show you later, a big industry in every town, and particularly Buncrana, was boot and shoe making. And often, I'd ask myself, why was that such a big industry? It was the second, the turn of the 1900s, leather industry, boot and shoe, was the second biggest exporter next to agriculture. And of course, what fed that was wars. Every soldier needed his boots, every soldier needed his belts, everything. And of course, it was happening all the time. So that particular industry was huge. And it was big in Buncrana. And you can see here, we have sea fencibles, now we have yeomanry. Now what that's also telling us is, Inishowen and Buncrana, it wasn't a part of Ireland where the authorities were saying, that's nice and quiet up there, we just leave them alone. It certainly was. And what you'll also, I mean, in the maps you'll see we have the revenue police, because Potching was huge, and the revenue police. But what the British government were doing was setting up systems of eyes and ears through their various formal structures. Whether it was soldiers, whether it was revenue police, whether it was sea fencibles, they had all of this way of gathering data. Okay, now we use mobile phones and texting, and we can do, but there it was eyes and ears of individuals who lived in the town. Distillation was largely illegal, but there was legal distillation as well. And William Leffam in Bunk big distillery, but it wasn't in Buncrana. He lived in Buncrana, but his distillery was in Derry. But he happily lived there. Now, another interesting thing, when you're looking for who lived in an area at the time, in the 1800s, they started doing sort of like yellow pages. And this one was called Piggott's Directory. And what they did is they went round the town and they just found out everybody that was living in the town, what they were doing, and they published it in a big book. And obviously they were making money out of it because they sold quite a few. So Piggott's was an early one. And of interest to me is you had another McNutt, James, who was a publican in the short bob in Derry, and that was in the 1820s. And Slater's directory, which I'll come to later, has quite a detailed account of who was living in the town of Buncrana and what they were doing. So we get it. We're starting now in the 1800s. We're starting to get a greater sense of real names and real data of who populated the various houses and businesses in the town. So what I'm going to invite you to do shortly is we can start with directories. We can move on to tithes. Now, everybody paid a tithe, whether you were the established church or not. It was a huge issue. And agrarian unrest was huge in Inishowen. But the documents are there, and it gives us some little insight into who were the landowners of the time. They then have Griffith's valuation, which gives us some further information on who were the landowners. And then we have what's now held in the valuation office in Dublin, what they call the council books, and I have copies of the Buncrana Main Street there. So you can see practically how a plot of land changed hands over the 1800s, and a house. And it's very useful if you're interested in your own genealogy or your own community, being able to do that. But what was happening in the town, again, we know about the 1901 and 1901, there was a census every 10 years. Unfortunately, the only ones that exist intact are 1901 and 1911. 1921, 31, 41, 51 were done. But during the War of Independence and Civil War, they all got burnt and lost. So what remains are simply the summaries of what was returned. So we can tell that Buncrana Town in 1821 had 198 people living in it. 10 years later, it had 1,000. So what happened between 1821 and 1831 that the population grew from 200 to 1,000? That's a huge growth in the population. So, and this also happened in other urban centres. Derry had a huge growth during this period. And some of the rationale is the linen industry was collapsing. Flax growing, because cotton was being imported and it was cheaper. Flax growing wasn't as lucrative. But also, the crackdown on illicit distillation was so severe that small farmers couldn't make any additional income. So what do? You go into the town in the hope that you might be able, using whatever skill or trade you had, made a living. So the town between 1821 and 1831 grew enormously. Now, the only area in Inishowen, it's a world dropped in population. Now, the interesting thing about that is 1798 was the big night Irishman, and that was largely driven because the penal laws didn't just affect the Catholic community. Presbyterians and those not of the established church were quite upset about it and annoyed. And tithes, they were not happy with. So large numbers of Presbyterians emigrated, uprooted and failed. So we're seeing populations grow and populations drop in the same area. And one of it is tithes. Now, an interesting story for me in that is I had an opportunity 2 years ago to visit Nova Scotia and Halifax. And Halifax is this beautiful port town. But Nova Scotia was planted by by a man called Alexander McNutt. And Alexander McNutt took boatloads of people from Donegal and Derry over to Nova Scotia because he had a land grant. And I have a copy of his land grant up there on the... I didn't know this when I went to Halifax, by the way. I don't even know how I cut. That's very interesting. And I had a moment to spare. And I said, to someone, who can tell me about this man, Alexander McNutt? And they said, look, go to the library in Dalhousie University. Halifax isn't a huge town. And they have all the records there. So I said, I'll go on. So I went down and I said, look, I just happened to hear about Alexander McNutt. He said, oh, yeah. There's a book on his life. He came from Donegal. He got the permission. He got a land grant, provided he could go back to Donegal and Derry and bring loads of people over. Never heard of him. He's not. There's divided opinion on him. Of course, planters tend to have that. Those that did well out of the plantation are very happy with what he did. Those that were displaced weren't one bit happy with what he did. And those that he displaced were the Acadians. And the Acadians were the original French settlers in Nova Scotia. They did all the fur trading. Married locally, the local indigenous population, and were known as Acadians. And they were all displaced down through the Appalachian Mountains to make way for the new plantation. And then now Cajun music and Cajun food all originated from these Acadians that left Nova Scotia. Now they've rediscovered their heritage back in Nova Scotia. But Nova Scotia is populated by significant proportions of Irish settlers, and a lot of them came from this area. Nova Scotia, as the name suggests, New Scotland celebrate their Scottish heritage. Only recently have they come to really acknowledge their Irish connections and their Irish I'll come back to that. The Taitha Plotmans are also a great source of information. And this is a snapshot of the Taitha Plotman group for Buncrana. So this was paid initially in kind to the established church. And initially it was paid usually a percentage of what you produced off the land that you owned. Eventually, that wasn't sustainable, so it was translated into a monetary. Now, the tithe collector in Buncrana was William McNutt. William McNutt lived in Buncrana town, and he was married to Jane McNutt, and he was the tithe collector. He also owned quite a bit of land around Buncrana. Now, Johnny, before you start panicking, it's a different thing. I can't prove it. Might have to do DNA tests. But in the type of plot and books, what's really interesting for them is who owned the land, who was paying the tithes, and of course how much they paid told you what the significance of their holdings actually was. He also worked with a guy called John Dysart, and they also did the tithes in Burt and up around that area. And I have some of his documents. The most interesting one, which you is in 1834, he had a house of tubing. Hot coals were put on the thatch roof, and 15 people in the house were burnt out. They weren't killed, they were burnt out. It enraged the people of Buncrana. Well, it enraged, if you look at the name, it enraged those that were landed so much that they put an ad in the paper, I have it over there, with a reward of £200 if anybody. And it's interesting, if anybody, and then in brackets, other than those that committed the offence, come forward with information leading to their arrest. And that was probably
I'd love to know that they ever get it. You nearly could be an arrangement for yourself. It's not that money.
But tithes, I mean, it was a huge burden on everybody. And I mean, the agrarian unrest in Inishowen and around Buncrana carried on right throughout the 1800s. I mean, we had the ancient order of Hibernians, we had the Board of Ireland. There was lots of groups operating in and around the area purely to thwart anybody paying tithes. Now, in the little book, I did a quick analysis of who owned most of the land according to the tithes. And it's interesting, you'll see names there to recognise. You know, local history is local history, so please don't read anything good or bad into what you're in. It's just part of our local history. But you can see how families own the land. And we also now have maps that tell us what parcels of land they owned. And it's really quite interesting, because this is the urban town developing in a variety of ways. Now, just note some of the names there, because the interesting is, as of even now, back then, okay, the key to becoming influential was obviously you had the right religion, you had some form of an education, and you possessed land. The history of Buncrana is all about changing land, changing hand. That was the most valuable commodity that existed at the time. Now, you know, we've learned also in the last few years that mentality didn't change very much, because we've got ourselves into a huge lot of difficulty economically, because the same mentality existed. Buying up land for ridiculous prices, trying to sell it off at inflated prices, and then the crash comes. And the crash hit Buncrana two or three times during the 1800s. Buncrana was sold several times during the 1800s. So, why are these names of importance? Well, firstly, William McNutt, they put up the rewards. Now, Tristan Kennedy, £30, I mean, that's a lot of money, £200. You know, you're talking about hundreds of thousands in rewards. And you can see, so all these families, you have William Bateman, John Alexander, Samuel McNutt, William McNutt, were so upset about this, that they got a huge reward for anybody that could deal with that. So we're starting to see some families, but here's the real picture of Buncrana, because I mentioned the other thing that, in fairness to the British administration, Jesus, they knew how to do their commissions. I mean, we think it's bad now when you listen to inquiries into this and inquiries into this. These guys were at it non-stop. The good news is all this exists. This was one that they did on poverty in Ireland in 1837, and this was specifically about Buncrana. And what they told us was deserted children, yes, bastard children, yes, widows, 130 widows, incapable of work, 200, immigrating to Scotland, 30, how do families survive, begging, how many persons survive by begging, 120, lodging for bed. Now, this is the interesting thing about the town. Everybody that had accommodation took people in. So it's a dire story, but it does suggest a community that look. And I mean, I know myself, when you grew up, your mother and father, if anybody came to the door, you never let them pass. That was drilled into you. But there was another Buncrana, and while this was going on, out on the Swilly, a novel and splendid night of entertainment aboard two British ships. And all the good gentry of Buncrana were dancing till dawn with food, the best available. But that wasn't enough. Once they'd done that, then a few months later, they held another ball on shore. And again, the Todds hosted. So here you had the British admiralty pulling in. They held a big banquet on board, and then a few months later, when they're back in, they held the ball. Now, that's happening, right? At the same time, you have destitution for hundreds. And that wasn't uncommon. that wasn't, you know, that was all, that was quite common. Now, some might argue there are parts of Ireland today where that's starting to emerge again. So again, the point I was making, you know, the reason your group and what you're doing is so important is this allows us to really reflect on the type of society we want moving forward. Now, I have to point out, this does sound as if I'm picking names out and saying, look, I'm having a big street and everybody else in the main street is... no, that isn't the case. These were good people. They really did what they had to do. So here's another example, 1839. This was a bombing supper to raise funds for the poor of the town. Okay. So, you know, if you get a chance to read through this, you'll have to make up your own minds. But in the midst of this, now we have the downturn. And here you have another factory up for sale. But this case, it's lock, stock and barrel, 1842. So what we have here, sold by auction. So what's happening is, the previous ones, it was sold before, someone bought it, big bucks, thought they'd make a killing. Lo and behold, the economy crashed again, and they're selling. So, does that sound familiar? Is it just do we ever hear from
great?
And of course, at this time, we're now coming in, you know, famine is starting. We have the workhouse in Carandonna, and we're starting to see the numbers there, people. Although, in comparison to West Donegal, another part of wasn't critical. Well, not that it was critical for those that had to use evictions. We now have documentation. We know what level of evictions were happening. We know where they were happening. Now, it's fair to say, what's happening here is land clearance so we can get bigger holdings. You know, so, and that's not to say all landlords across the country were ruthless. Some weren't. Some really did try. But the reality was, if they improved your land, your rent went up. So you weren't going to improve your land, and then it meant it wasn't going to be more productive, which meant the landlord wasn't going to get any more rent. So it was all vicious. But you can see here, and again, and this is the beauty of it, you know, this information is available now. We can actually get, this is really data. This tells us who was evicted, who owned it, who was the landlord, and who was responsible for the evicted, and where did they go. The other interesting thing is, they kept these records. The British government was observing this now. You know, there's no doubt they failed the country miserably during the famine, absolutely miserably. They kept great records for a complete disaster and how they responded to famine. Again, more sales. And this time, huge property lots, all different lots being sold. Just logged off, give me any money. So all of the landowners, all of the big landowners, ran into serious economic depression. And where does that leave Buncrana? Well, we're seeing now 1841, 1851, so we're now in the midst of the famine, and you can see the population has dropped quite considerably in the town. Now, interestingly, the townland of Ardrabbin sustained its population. The town didn't. And the reason is, if you had a little bit of land, you might have had some hope of economic living. But essentially, the population dropped to 84%. Now, it's also possible they emigrated. But between going, you know, what were your options? You emigrated, you starved, or you went to the workhouse. But what we now can see, I know this is a pretty rapid run through a lot of information, so I apologize for that. This is the town at Griffith's valuation. Each of these numbers represents a plot of land, and we can track who the owners of those were now from this point onwards. But what we're seeing in Buncrana, it did sustain itself up to and through the famine. And probably a number of the reasons were Derry was close by, emigration to Scotland was an option. But also the community obviously were entrepreneurial and supported themselves. And there was significant investment in police, in soldiery, and other public services that allowed trades and shops to keep going as well. So overall, the impact wasn't huge. Now, what I have out on the tables for you is you can look at Griffith's valuation. You can then move to the council books. Council books, now the council books still have William Street and Townsend Street, but if you know that, say for my own family, you can find them on that. You can then, you'll notice that they're stored out in different coloured pens. That represents the year that it changed hands. Now these books are in, they exist in the valuation office. They're not online yet. Hopefully they will put them online. So these are just photocopies of them. But it is a fascinating record of how and who between different properties in the town. What I also have is the maps that go with them, and these numbers here put in a pencil for Griffiths, so you can see the different properties and who owned them, and you can follow that around. Which leads us back to 1866, the town was sold again. So now we're after the famine, and Buncrana went up for sale. Now, the interesting thing about the sale of Buncrana, this particular, it wasn't the whole town of Buncrana. Section of Buncrana, that property there, and the houses up on the main street, that was Bartley Park. Anybody ever hear of Bartley Park? Anybody ever hear of Bartley? That's the Pound Lane, or not, sorry, that's the down to the church, to the present. That there, I presume, Michael, that would be Josie's. That was called Bartley Park, and then there was houses up on that main street. All of that was sold in one lot. It was owned by John Gillespie. And John Gillespie, in the documents, the reason these are so important is it tells you who was renting the property. A.D. Doherty, Rose Bradley. You know, so you might see some little clues for yourself. It tells you what they were paying. And it was sold. Now, the lease for all that property was held by William McNutt. But William McNutt had died in 1836, so passed on to his widow, Jane McNutt, who subsequently did pass away, and her daughter then married Hughie's Ray, and that's the fine woman. But I had never heard of Bartley Park. So here's the town, we often passed it up and down the school, up and down the mass. A little bit of history sitting there to be discovered. Now that's just again to go back to Alexander McNutt. There are so many little stories in here that there might be just one that interests you. And what I'd like to suggest is go and inquire about it. Every family has a history. Every family has a story. And if you bring enough of those stories, you start to get a sense of the community that is Buncrana. As I walked through Halifax, I opened the phone book and the place was following me. To the extent that when I was waiting for a taxi and at the library, and the lady kindly had rang a taxi for me, and she said, "What's the name?" And I said, "McNutt." That's one of the few places I go to, I've ever been, where no one asked you, "What? Or how do you spell that?" It just didn't happen. But there was a man also waiting for a taxi, and he turned to me and said, "Are you anything to Mary McNutt?" And for a brief moment, I thought, but it so happened. I said, "No, sir, she's not." "No," I said, "sorry, it's not." There was a Mary McNutt in Halifax who was an artist, and he just said that. "No," I said, "you are just like." I said, "No, I'm different McNutt." He says, "Well, Don McNutt has an exhibition down in Halifax." So I got the tab on down, and there was Don McNutt with this exhibition of weaving, cloth making in the middle of Halifax. But it got even better, because then I discovered off Shelburne Harbour there's McNutt's Island. So Alexander McNutt lived his final years with his brother Bernard on McNutt's Island off Shelburne, off the
coast of Nova Scotia. Seemingly I couldn't claim it.
Now, did that help Vivi back at the start?
It did.
She delighted to hear all this.
And then, of course, as she could only do, she said, now what I want you to do is find out about John McNutt's family. And I said, they're all in America. Vivi, no, she said, they were all born in Ireland. John McNutt left Buncrana in the 1850s, joined the police constabulary, which after the famine, by the way, the vast majority of people that joined the police constabulary were Roman Catholic, which often is a misconception. And this lady here wrote a fantastic book on the what it was like being a policeman in the Irish constabulary in the 1800s. After the Fenian Rising, it became the Royal Irish Constabulary, the RIC. He served 30 years. He retired in 1885. He was stationed in this little town called Newcastle, which is the most beautiful area. It's in the middle of the Knockmel Downs, outside of Clonmel. Now, if you wanted to go somewhere that had the hills and the scenery that Buncrana gives you, that's where you go. But there's no sea. It's inland. How he got there, I have no idea. But he spent 30 years in this little village in Newcastle. Now, that was the heart of the Fenian Rising in Tipperary. So he was one busy man. And also, he was moved then to Inishowen in County Kilkenny. He had 10 children. Moved to Inishowen, and have you ever seen the movie Circle of Friends? Maybe Bates' movie that was set in Inishowen, this most beautiful little village. He then, when he retired in 1885, he moved to Waterford, had a shop in Waterford, and in 1901 they're in the census, in 1909 they all uprooted and went to hospital, except for one son of Stephen who stayed. I knew nothing about this man. It was never discussed in my family. But my father knew about him. Now, so why might that be? That period in Irish history was fairly rough and ready. Being in the police was not something that you wanted the streets of Buncrana celebrating. That's my grandfather there. That was taken in 1914. That's the National Volunteers Company in Buncrana. William McNutt, his father, who was John's brother, obviously, it just, the circumstances didn't allow any of that to be discussed or celebrated or shared. That was grandfather. Well, our grandfather. Now, I don't know who the other guys are, but this little photo has an inscription on the back. 1916. I would still follow my old teacher, whose inspiration did so much to make Ireland free, M. Garvey. I have no idea what that is, or the significance of it. But obviously, William McNutt, his son Patrick McNutt, who set up, William worked on the top of McGinn Avenue, Patrick set the shop up in the main street. I just have provided for you there, these are the old ledger books that he used to have of who got their shoes made in Buncrana, and you see some familiar names, you may even see your old family there, I'll tell you whether they paid the builder. And of course, our dilemma about how to properly spell the name continues. So my father Bill was McNutt, my brother Paddy McNutt, my father's brother Neil, who joined the Guards in 1935, is McNutt. And Neil's wife, Margaret, turned 122. She passed away in January at 103. And that whole family, I often wondered how did someone join the Guards, but now I have a kind of idea that there must have been something in it. He was based in Ballyhonus. Ballyhonus celebrated during the millennium, lots of celebration about Ballyhonus as a town, and they had quite a few poems. But Garvey not. But that's another little story. So Vivi got, how did the town develop? What was life like for Mel?
grandfather, and then she just said, no, I want you to go off and find out where the 10 of them all ended up. So that's the piece I'm working on now. Just from a local history point of view, Buncrana exists all over the world. I lived in Australia for a while, and outside the town I lived in was Buncrana. That Buncrana, when I went, was a cattle station. And the lady was married to an Arden. She left Buncrana in the early 1800s, found her way up to Lismore, and set up, they just lived in a big cattle station. Her grandnephew brought me in, and all she had was both cattle. This lady was the most amazing story. And finally, you never know what's been thrown at you. This lady is Paulette Hannah Gaillard. She's passed away as well, sorry. She writes romance novels. And she contacted me. Well, actually, she didn't contact her. I used to do distance learning courses, and her daughter was doing one online. At the end of the course, her daughter, Barbara Gaillard, said, "Dear Larry, love the course. Could I introduce you to my mother?" And in all my years of teaching, I know she was my mother. But then she said, her grandmother was a McNutt from Donegal. She sent all these books to my mother every night. And this one, which was one of her last ones, in the very last piece, she brings in a character called Robert McNutt. She passed, but it was Paula Tanner. So finally, just to wrap things up, this is the title of Plotman's book from Fawn. Just when I thought I was getting a handle that were really McNutt's, Johnny. The title of Plotman's book, 1749, spells it McNutt. N-A-G-H-T. So there's N-A-T-T, N-U-T-T, N-A-U-G-H-T, and N-A-G-H-T. The consensus is it's McNutt. And I mentioned that babies, one surviving uncle lived in Ireland, the nine emigrated to Boston. I went looking for him. And only recently I found Stephen's grave. He died in 1860. He was a carpenter. He had three children. And he died in 1939 and is buried in this old disused grave in Donegal. There's a great service called Graveyards of Ireland where they're recording now all the old graves. And a man called Vern Pauls had this photograph and had all the records of Stephen McNutt. 1939, my grandfather Patrick McNutt, that was the shoemaker, his brother died in Glasgow, in Greenock, Port Glasgow. He was buried in 1939. That's his cousin who was buried in 1939, and they never knew. So, genealogy helps your local history, and your local history helps us capture the wonderful story of the town of Buncrana. And I just want to thank you again for giving me the opportunity to share a few thoughts with you. And please have a look around.